All right, let's get started. I'm just up here for a few minutes today to welcome our guest, Dr. Farouk Elbaz, who's a professor at Boston University, but has done so many different things. And I won't go through them all because that was part of your reading assignment, was to read some of his extensive biography. I think I said this last time, I'll say it again. Of all of the guests you'll have here, you will hear many of them say, Apollo was the height of my career and the most interesting thing I did. And I doubt Dr. Elbaz would say that because he's done so many interesting things since then. Maybe we'll hear a little bit about it. You read a little bit about it. I first met him about 15 years ago. He runs the Center for Remote Sensing in Archaeology at BU. And I was very involved for a long time in new technologies for mapping shipwrecks with robots in very, very deep water. Did a presentation there and then have an article in the edited volume that came out of it, which is a great point of pride for me because he's the editor, so his name appears on my CV. And it's a very nice association to have in one CV. And don't really want to say too much more. He's going to open up with a bunch of comments, but we have three people who sort of prepared more in-depth questions, but everybody is invited to ask questions about any aspect of the program, the relationship with the astronauts, the site selection, the geology, so many different things. And he was even responsible for naming the Apollo 17 command module, Endeavour, which then became one of the shuttle names. So thank you
many
so
thanks.
Much for coming.
Thank you very much. Now I come to MIT. Whenever I come here, I think that things will change, but very little has changed. Everything's still the same, the same old building, same everything. The one thing that changed considerably is the fact that we have so many women here, which is a great change. Changed the look of the whole thing. So this is a wonderful opportunity for me to talk to you people because you're engineers, and very few engineers would look into the sciences with a kind eye. And I'm delighted that you're not just looking into the science, but looking into history, because you're combining the history and the sciences and the accomplishment in terms of what it had gone through. And that is historical, which is very important. So when you are in your field in engineering somewhere, you, if you apply this kind of thing that this course had taught you to think about the development of this thing, whatever it is, and the historical the movement is wonderful. In my case, I would like to tell you just how I got involved in this whole thing. My degree was in geology, street geology, and my PhD thesis was on the lead and zinc deposits of Southeast Missouri. This was a fascinating thing to the astronauts because they thought that I was an astronomer. I'm knowledgeable about the moon, and they talk about it in terms of in ways that they think it is wonderful and so on. And I remember during the mission Apollo 15, we were training the crews in the Cape, and we had a party of sorts. We were going to cook some hamburgers, and Joe Allen and I were sitting down while the three crewmen were talking to the nurse. And then Joe Allen, who is a PhD in physics, asked me, by the way, who was your supervisor? I said, your thesis supervisor. He said, well, somebody you wouldn't know. He said, what do you mean you wouldn't know? What's his name? I said, no, you wouldn't. If I tell you his name, you wouldn't really know who he is. He said, why? When didn't you study with Kuiper or Turner? And he mentioned two or three of the biggest names in astronomy. I said, no. I said, where did you get your degree? I said, from in Missouri. He said, Missouri? How come? Because he never heard of anybody in Missouri that has a telescope. So he said, what was the name of your supervisor, your thesis advisor? I said, a guy by the name of G.C. Amstutz, Chris Amstutz. He said, what was your PhD on? I said, the lead and zinc deposits of Southeast Missouri. He said, what? Hey, guys, he called the crew. You're putting your hands in the life of a guy who's an expert on lead and zinc. And that was the truth. I was an expert on lead and zinc, and that's why I came here to work on the crystal forms of certain mineral called bravite, which is a cobalt nickel oxide. And so when I got into the program, I was a straight geologist, and I knew about photography of the Earth and the the landforms and so on. And when we got into the lunar business, we started to looking at the features of the Earth, trying to interpret them as the features of the moon. What would they look like and how would they differ and so on? And my involvement with the crews and with the program in general started when we began to plan for photography. That's how I came into the program, really. I became a member of the photo team, so I would plan the kinds of places where we need pictures of. For what purpose? Well, to understand the moon, number one, and number two, to apply all of this knowledge that we gain from photographs in the selection of later sites or later missions. And when I entered into the program in 1967, the groups of geologists that were working with the program in general had been working on it for about 7 years. So there was a bunch of geologists trying to train the astronauts since 1960. So I came in 7 years later. And when I arrived, I found out and I heard and I felt that the crews actually didn't want to touch a geologist with a 10-foot pole. They were disgusted with the fact of geology. Why? Because they were taught in classes like this about minerals and their composition and their interlocking relationships and what would these interlocking relationships do as far as the rocks are concerned and details. And some cases they would look, they will show them a microscope and they will show them the interlocking of the crystals within a rock, and they were disgusted with this whole thing. And they would say, we're not going to have a goddamn microscope on the moon. What the hell are we doing? And what's the difference between such and such and such and such with mentioning mineral names? And so I realized that the astronauts are really off the case of geology, and we are not going to get as much knowledge of geological features from them as we possibly can. So that was just about at the time when we were planning for Apollo 11, and we heard that Apollo 13 crew will be this and this and that, and the crews were named, and then the names of the crews of Apollo 13, because we would work on them about 2 years ahead of time. And there was a fine geologist that in Houston who had known some of the astronauts in a nicer way. And I told them that I would like to speak to any one of these guys and to just tell them about lunar features and how they would be able to tell us a little more about them if they learned a little bit about them beforehand. He said, the only guy that you will talk to about that might be Ken Mattingly. And that's in preparation for Apollo 13. They were assigned, but they were not assigned specific posts yet, who's going to be the CSM, the command module pilot, and who's going to be the LM, and so on. So I said, okay, I would like to speak with him. So he arranged a meeting. I went to Ken Mattingly, and they told him this and that, and he said, then what the hell would that give me? I said, no, I'm going to tell you about the features of the moon and how it's easier for you to mark to figure out the approach to the landmarks only. So I said, okay, the landmarks are about 7 locations on the moon, on the near side, whereby if they can look through the sextant, which is in the spacecraft, and as they get to the landmark under the crosshairs, they would say mark. And then we would know exactly where they are at that point. And they give them 7 because the engineers down in Houston only needed 3 to 4 maximum. So they give them 7 because they know that they're going to miss some. So I thought, well, we'll try to get you to learn about them a little beforehand. So I said, okay, I'll give you 1 hour, and 1 hour only. I said, sure. You come to the Cape, I finish up my exercise at 6, and we have dinner at 7, so that 1 hour. I said, fine. So I went to the Cape, and they took pictures from lunar orbiter, put them on the wall like this, and put the revolutions number 1 and number 2, whereby they would be the most significant revolutions as far as the knowledge of their orbit, the exact position of the orbit around the moon, where it is, not roughly, but exactly. So I went through the things one by one like this, and I told them about the landmarks, and we'll say, before you get to the landmark, so that you're looking at this, when you come to the sextant and look at it at a prescribed time, so that you can go over it like this, and then say, mark when you see that little bugger that we mark them at number one or two or three. Then before, if you don't know how the terrain looks before you get to it, then you'll miss it. But if you prepare yourself before you get to it, then you see where it is and that. So oh, that's interesting. So we went through it and he said, look at that. Well, these two craters are kind of joined. They look like a doublet. I said, good, let's call it doublet. And we called it. And this one, a whole bunch of surgeons, that's a bunch of craters. That looks like a snowman. Good, let's call it snowman. And they write it down, snowman. As we went through it in 1 hour, and they will go through it like this one by one. And then we went over it one more time. And then I said, now look at me and then tell me, before the approach of landmark F3, it's called, I don't know what the F for stood for, but landmark number three, he would say, ah, that's the one that you get to a dark area like that, and then you come to the doublet, and then it will be on the rim of the such and such. Okay, good, and number four. Number four will be this and this and that, blah, 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 blah. And he actually memorized the locations because he could visualize what he just saw and so on. So he said, well, can you stay with us for dinner? I said, sure. And we had dinner, roughly with the whole bunch. And then he said, well, when can you come back? So I thought, that was it. So we began to do like this. And then we began to look at the what he would look through from window 3 as opposed to window 5 and the spacecraft and what the scenery on the lunar surface would be and what this and this and that. And he became very knowledgeable about that, the whole orbit and what it does and so on. And then one time I was going to the astronaut office building, which is number 4 in Houston. I was walking through the glass door at the outside, and here comes a guy. I was going in and he was going out. Just at the door, he said, hey, are you Farak El Bayez? I said, yes. He said, I'm Stu Rusa. I'm going to be appointed on Apollo 14. And listen, I want you to make me smart as smart as Ken. hell no, I want you to make me smarter than Ken. Now, the astronauts are incredibly competitive people. They competed in everything as far as their knowledge of the machines and knowledge of spacecraft and the landing and the equipment and all of that. And if I knew that if I get them excited about the lunar surface, and then they begin to compete as far as that knowledge is concerned, there is no limit of where they went. And therefore, the knowledge from the moon began to continue like this from the first mission all the way to the Apollo 17, where every single astronaut became a first-rate geologist with all kinds of knowledge about the location of things on the moon and so on. And the reason why I'm saying this whole story is that the astronauts in general are very good engineers. So they had the basics of engineering. They also knew the spacecraft well, and they knew what works and what doesn't. And then in the sciences, there is no such thing. We don't really have anything that is so fixed that you can see it, because everything that we have is kind of imaginary. And we say this might be that, and this might come from that, and this might have come from such and such, but there's somebody else that said, no, it came from some other thing. So there's kind of loose imaginations that can control what we really come to underline. What is it that we think is important, which is very different from the engineering approach, with 1 + 1 = 2. Because in our sciences, 1 + 1 can be 230 or 2.3 or 1.8, could very easily, with no discussion until we could come to a consensus that might be good enough to be 2. So, and if that is the case, then it is very important to have someone understand the scientific method or the scientific mind and the way it works. And it is also very important to have somebody that can fuse the exact engineering knowledge with some of the information that we can get from observing the lunar surface and describing it and so on. And And that became a very significant part of the Apollo program, where the astronauts themselves had added a great deal of information before the mission, before we got to the rocks, before we had anything in hand. And it was all due to the fact that they began to compete as far as knowledge of the moon is concerned. And that competition worked fabulously within Apollo 15, where Dave Scott specifically, and you guys were going to talk to him or see him soon, between him and Jack Schmidt, and because Jack was a an alternate astronaut for an Apollo 15, and Dave Scott's wife took courses in geology so that she can talk to him. so they became wonderful conveyors of the sciences, and indeed the Apollo program as a whole, it was a group of people that tried to get as much as possible from each and every step of the way, and indeed the knowledge that we received from the moon is more from their own observations and from own selection and the way they looked at the rocks and the way they sampled the materials, because when you look at the whole terrain and you see a whole bunch of rocks. But one of their great teachers, Lee Silver, taught them how to think about that and think about how many suites of these rocks are here, meaning what kind of variety in these rocks, show me the three most important groups of things in here, with materials or types of rocks. And these kinds of things became very essential in their selection and their descriptions and what they said on the moon and the way they sampled the surface. And from all of that, we certainly gained a great deal, a lot more than we would have if we just had either machines doing it only, or people that were not well trained in observations and in the selection of what is scientifically valuable. I have no idea what you people are going to ask about, and therefore would let you have at it. What interests you more? Yes.
I guess I'll start here.
Sure.
I wrote some down beforehand. So, as far as determining the landing sites, I understand you were involved in that part as well as with the astronauts. I understand that in the original ones, the criteria was mostly like, let's find a place to set down that isn't going to destroy the lander.
Good.
How was the negotiation between what was sort of the safe path versus what was going to be scientifically interesting?
Yeah.
How did you guys negotiate that, especially as the later missions came and they landed in more feature-rich
very good
environments?
I'm going to start with the very beginning.
Sure.
With Apollo 11, where would the first landing would be? And now you know that the landing sites for Apollo 11 were five. It was not one. And you take the reason for this is the fact that that segment of the lunar equator is the place where it is easiest to land. And it's easiest for us to communicate and easiest for everything else to happen. And therefore, if you land anywhere near the equator, it is better and easier and so on for the engineers to get the spacecraft there. And since it is the first landing, we had no idea whether the launch will be done today or tomorrow or the day after, because there might be some problems in the launch. So even if you decide that this will be the launch date and we're all set, what if it's delayed? So we had to select five sites, all along very close to the equator, and all of them are good enough to land. Okay, what's good enough to land? There are two components. One is that the surface of the lunar surface does not have a tilt more than 13 degrees. If that's more than 13 degrees, the spacecraft will topple over when it lands, which was a very critical and very tough measure to do, since we had no maps of the moon. So we had no idea what's the tilt on the moon. So we had to define a whole new procedure to figure out what's the tilt of this place versus this place versus this place. And we generated a whole new science, photometry. And that is, when you have, if the sun is shining from this side and you have a surface in here, and if the solar rays are at right angle to that surface, it will be absolutely white. very bright. And if the surface is right here, it is in the shade, and so it will be absolutely black. So everywhere in between are the shade degrees. So we measured with the densitometer. We took the lunar orbital pictures taken previous to Apollo. And you measure how dark it is, one step at a time like that, until we find some, what are the places where there that are like that, very close to being as flat as we could possibly get, or less than 10 degrees, based on the measure that we made with the densitometer. Because we're really looking at the densitometry, the density of the film, or the density of the brightness on the film strip. Okay, so this was number one. Number two is that surface is lacking rough terrain, boulders. If there is a boulder more than a foot like that on one side, and the spacecraft lands on one leg of the limb, lands on that one, it will also topple over, and it will goodbye to the mission. So where are the places on the moon that do not have blocks? Since we did not have pictures to show us the blocks. We didn't have picture to show us a block half of this, the size of this half of this room at the beginning. So where are the, so we had to theorize geologically. Where are blocks? What generates blocks on the moon? So a lot of impacts or volcanism, because we really had still, at that time, we still had the two competing theories that all of the round things on the moon were made by volcanic eruptions that formed the volcanoes, or by meteorite impacts to form round things due to the impact. Okay, so what is the difference in these cases? Okay, if all of these round things were all volcanic vents, then when a volcano erupts, it would have all of these big pieces and send them all over the place. So we'd have something in here, and the ejecta will be all over the place. But if it was an impact of a meteorite, then you have something like this, and the roughness will be closest to the rim as you possibly can. As you go further away from the from the rim, you find smaller and smaller craters. And so therefore, smaller blocks. And therefore, I measured that if you go 10 times the distance of the crater itself, you find no roughness whatsoever. So we had to think about the number of craters per unit area. Yeah, so the number of craters per unit area. So take a piece of the moon and see craters, all kinds of sizes like that. And you count as you go through the strips, that strip in here, all of it, every single inch of it. We had pictures, and we had a whole slew of people hired by a company to sit down and just count craters per unit area, every single square inch of the whole damn thing, all from this here. And so they would get to find that number. And then it became known as the number. But it wasn't easy to say, so they actually called it the N number. They didn't know what to say. So the N number is, if you have a low N number, then this area has fewer craters. A high N number, this means lots of craters. So you find the place that's number one, that was measured by the densitometer to be as close to flat as we think, and with a low N number, so that should be at the least number of blocks as you will. So this had to be taken thoroughly for the first mission, and a little bit less in the second mission, because we learned a little more, a little bit less in the third mission, and so on as we went, as we learned, and so on. However, as we came to your point, which is very important, when you came to the really rough terrain, or where the spacecraft, when they land like this, there is a mountain range, and we want them to land in here, but they're coming that way. So the radar, of course, the radar would working with from the mission to see their elevation as they go along, but this means that they really have to take the shape of this approach very carefully in the planning of the mission. And the Houston engineers in general hated this whole thing with this. And then Apollo 15, starting with Apollo 15, they objected totally on the fact that we wanted to land in this kind of place. And they called this They came to NASA headquarters in Washington, D.C., objecting to our selection completely and totally and saying no to it because they said they want us to land in a box canyon. So this was called a box canyon. And when the Apollo program director told them to revise their measurements and do something different, said that they went back and they're all bitched about for a few months, but they came through. They developed the calculations to go about it. So this was a very good question in relation to what did we learn at the very beginning, or what did we know? And in real life, in these cases, we didn't know a thing. And then as knowledge expanded for the selection of the very rough to get to sites. Does this answer?
Sure. So I remember watching a video on the Missouri S&T website about the Apollo 11 landings and your surprise of how the descent and the location where they actually landed compared to where you guys planned was very different because of higher gravitational pull. Were there any other surprises from subsequent missions about the landing sites that defied your expectations despite the planning?
Not really, because it was so bad in Apollo 11. And it was so bad because, and we thought we really figured it out, but we didn't, because it is in the Apollo 11 case, we had selected we always make an ellipse for landing, and we say this is the landing point, and this landing point is the nicest place as far as this is concerned. And also the best place as far as the roughness is concerned, as the N number is concerned. So this would be like the, so the whole area in general has a reasonably good N number, and this here is, all of it has a reasonably flat terrain, but this area right here is the best. No craters, and so the Apollo 11 was supposed to come in like this, and then like that. And it didn't. It landed, and we knew the scenery in here and so on, and then he started landing, and he apparently landed right here. And this was like 7 kilometers, so it's no small parade. It's a very huge distance. And when they landed, we didn't know where they landed. And throughout the day when they were on the moon, there was all kinds of discussion because we could barely figure out where it is because there was a crater that was just in here that we had no idea about that specific shape of the crater. And it was the one that he was going to land over here. When he saw it, he was going to land in the middle of this very blocky terrain, and then he had to take the controls. But if he let it be, it would land in this very blocky terrain, and the mission would be lost. So he took the controls and moved out like that with very few seconds of fuel remaining. So this was a shakeroo as far as the whole program is concerned. And I remember Dick Slayton, he was the head of the astronaut corps, because there were all the kinds of discussion. The relay people would tell us where we think they landed right here, and we look at the terrain and we say absolutely not, it's not, and we get discussion like that, and everybody was leaving it to the geologists to say where they landed because we can see the pictures. And we know the terrain, and these engineers don't give a damn what the terrain looks like. And I remember this Dick Slayton coming into the room and looking like this, and he didn't know whom to look at. And he looked at me and he said, "Where the hell did they land?" And they left. Meaning we are disgusted, find out or figure it out. So this we knew right before Apollo began. We had a lunar orbiter mission that went all around the moon several times like this. And as it came to, if you see the surface of the moon, and you see these the round things that look like the face of the man on the moon, they're all filled with a rock called basalt, this dark spots right there. And basalt is a rock that has a great deal of iron and magnesium. That's why it is dark. And as the lunar orbiter would move over the basalts, it came closer to the moon a little bit, just a little nudge. So these are mass concentrations. If this is filled with heavy rock material, and the spacecraft is moving like this, as this is its orbit, as it's moving over the regular moon, looking at a white moon, it's moving like that. If it, when it comes like that, it gets pulled down a little, because this is heavier, so it attracts it a little more, severe gravitational pull. And we thought that all of that was corrected before the Apollo mission, because we knew the mass cons right before that happened. So, and we realized that maybe that's the reason that they had not corrected completely, and it turned out that they did correct completely, but there was some miscalculation in the orbital path of their own making. So that was corrected on Apollo 12, because the objective on Apollo 12 was not to for a safe mission or to get rocks or to do it. It was pinpoint landing. So this was a challenge to the Houston engineers, that all we really need for Apollo 12 is pinpoint landing, and we're going to give you a location of a surveyor that landed here. We know where it is, and we want you to land on top of it. So they were within close range to walk to it. So this was the number one priority, that pinpoint landing, because of the mess during the after the Apollo 11 landed, and we had no idea where in the hell was the landing site, because we prepared for something, and they had maps and so on, and the maps couldn't work because they landed somewhere else.
There's an interesting software angle to that too, because they, as we saw in that little film of Apollo 11, they knew they were landing long.
Yeah.
But they couldn't do anything about it in those final seconds.
Yeah, seconds, yeah.
And they were very hesitant to change the software from Apollo 11 to Apollo 12 because they had something proven that worked. And one of the only changes they made was, and on all the subsequent missions, when they knew they were landing long, late in the game, they could add one correction, into the software and tell it, oh, and because, you know, Armstrong saw the crater go by early.
Yeah.
He knew exactly how many seconds he was long.
Yeah.
And then they were able to give that one little correction in, and it improved a lot of them.
Yeah.
We'll hear more about that.
Further question on this question of landing site conditions. Mm-hmm. You recall that prior to Apollo 11, in fact, back prior to Surveyor, Professor Gold was warning the National Research Council that the astronauts and the LEM would sink into this bottomless pallet.
Yep.
So quite aside from the business of dust blowback, which did occur, was this concern. Tell us what was the feeling of your own, the scientific community, about whether this was in fact a possible major threat to the landings?
Yeah.
There were two scientists that shook up the Apollo program regularly. And that was Tommy Gold and Jack Green. Jack Green was the volcano magnet who would not accept the fact that any of these craters on the moon were made by impact. Everything is volcanic. Mm-hmm. And Tommy Gold was saying that the whole lunar surface has been impacted so much that everything on the moon will be like soft powder, and the spacecraft is going to land like this, and the will be swallowed by the dust. And he was very, he had a big name, and he also had a capacity to write long-winded letters, minimum of 2-3 letters to three pages to the NASA administration or to Congress and so on, regularly, every 2 weeks or so much. And we knew Tommy, and he would come, and I would try once to sit down with Tommy way before Apollo 11 to prove to him that we geologists think that this is solid rock because. And we showed him an oblique picture of the Copernicus crater that which took with Apollo, with the lunar orbiter intentionally to look at in the face of the crater, like the rim of the crater. So if you have a crater like this and you look at it this way, then you can see this here. And we saw at least three very long, very clear strata, meaning rock layers within that rock. And I said, Tommy, come and see. Look at this one. This one here is such and that's why we're seeing such and such. He said, you think about this as a solid rock. I said, yeah, because you see it like this. He said, yeah. But these are dust layers that have been compacted into solid rocks. But if you touch it, it will fall apart again. So it did not start. So you're not starting from rock. You're starting with dust that was compacted. And in real life, by the time of Apollo 11, no one was with Tommy.
Partly because Surveyor had
because we had all of the landings of the Surveyor. Yeah, so the interpretation from Ranger said that this is going to be rocky, as also if it touches the ground and it's going to dust, you would not feel the impact.
Right.
Yeah, but the Ranger, boom, as it touched, it broke apart, so meaning that the surface is rocky. And and with the Surveyor, it landed, and we got pictures from it after it landed around the terrain, and we knew what it has landed on right there in the site. So the Surveyor to us was a total, complete proof that the surface is going to take care of that will be rocky, and it will not affect the mission. Sure. Yes?
I'm just curious, because it seems from doing a lot of the reading so far, scientists in general seem to feel like they're getting a short shrift of the manned space program. Certainly you see that in Wiesner's arguments of we shouldn't be sending men to the moon, we should be doing robotic or unmanned exploration. But you mentioned at the end of your talk that you felt like you got a lot more information from the manned missions and putting people on the moon's surface than you would have via unmanned systems. And I wonder if you can comment on that disparity. Are you in the minority thinking that we got more out of it from the scientific realm by putting men on the moon, or is it solely based on the geology and that aspect of it? Or
it's a minority, but not a small minority. And it's like 49%. So it's not so there are more people that would say that because of the expense. But the interaction between the mind and the eye is enormous. That the human capacity of interpreting things is nothing you can do to the machine. And someday might be, but there is no way that to think that a machine could have selected the rocks that were selected. It could not have selected the sites of photograph. You could not have the observations that happened in there that directed our attention to this or to that, to that, the orange soil of Apollo 17, the crystal, the very hard crystalline rock of the old, most ancient, the Genesis rock. What made you go and pick that one? Because it's highly crystalline material that would actually would be something of that nature that in his mind to do it. So there is no question in my mind that the astronauts did add a great deal that could not possibly have been added by a machine.
Yes. You base a study of the moon surface from your understanding of geology. So were there any differences that you observed that were different from your current expectations? And what kind of difficulties do you experience when you were gathering and interpreting information about the moon?
Okay, before the Apollo missions, there were all kinds of theories that just were, I don't want to say it badly, but but there were all kinds of theories that directed the attention of all kinds of people towards this theoretical aspect because of the scientific standing of the proponents of it. Harold Urey would say, and everybody would hear it, and everybody would think about it, and so on. Somebody with that kind of name would say it, and all of these professors that Joe Allen was searching for, who was your professor, it would say something, Kuiper does or that, it would say it, and that's it. You will learn that, you will take it as it is, because these were the giants in the field. But some of these thoughts were really not based on real observations or real knowledge. They were about the way I think about it. And so Harold Urey, for instance, his idea was the fact that all of these round circles and that I drew in here were the meteorites that hit the surface of the moon. And because of the impact, they actually became molten and they froze later. So this will be the meteorite material, such and such. And to us, you can't have a meteorite hit like that and then stay in one piece. I mean, it's going to fragment. And why would it be like that? Because he would say that this is going to be mostly iron. So this whole, all of these dark places are going to be totally iron, because there was a hint that there is more iron in these places than in other places because of the color and the intensity of the light that it reflects. So there were some of these grandiose ideas that were not based on real scientific notions, but they were based on scientific interpretation that turned out to be out of the realm. Yeah, so the Apollo materials proved them wrong. there are still some basic questions of where did the moon come from? Is it related to the Earth or not? So, but at least as far as the lunar composition is and the age, the material that makes the moon, how did it develop? What the kind of history? What is old and what's young on the moon? All of that has been settled by the Apollo program.
Are you convinced that the most current theory of the moon having been a piece of the Earth that was blown away is correct?
Not necessarily. Yeah, they are really all still functioning. They're all the three theories. The moon was was captured by the Earth. Yeah, it was a kind of the wife of the Earth. Something was moving around and kept that Earth. The moon is the daughter of the Earth. Came out of it, yeah. Or the two of them are related. So the moon may be the sister of the Earth. So it is really still all, because there is not a single piece of information that tells you this is this case and all the rest are not. The moon is different still from the Earth enough. It is distinct compositionally. It is distinct from the internal structure. The age of its surface features are different. So any one of the theories at the very beginning of 3.9 or some such thing years ago are still viable. Whether it made like that or whether one asteroid, one huge planetoid came close to the Earth and moved that material out, but it wouldn't go away, so it stayed near the Earth and then collected again into the form of the moon. All of them are still viable. There are enough scenarios to make any one of these be the one that you would agree with now. Yeah. Yes?
So we saw that the Apollo program was mainly started for reasons of national prestige and politics. So when do you feel that people started to really pay attention to the scientific value of going to the moon, especially senior people at NASA?
Okay, from the very beginning, there was that was still in there, even in the minds of the people that worked on the rocket itself, Werner von Braun and Kurt Debus and so on, the guys that were working on the V2 rocket for Hitler to shoot these rockets at London, are the ones that made the Saturn V for us in Apollo. After World War II, they joined the Americans and they came. The American army took them and they started working on the rocketry. And there at the time, when there was during the Cold War, and the people were competing with the U.S. and the Soviet Union were competing to who's going to rule the world. In the U.S. there were all kinds of groups doing these kinds of things, that to move things into space by getting enough rocketry to send things up into space, and it was after Sputnik in 1957. It was President Eisenhower who thought that this is nonsense to have three different groups in the three different the Navy and the Air Force and the Army working on rocketry and so on. He said, stop this nonsense, get one agency only and make it a civilian agency so you can benefit from the brain power in the civilian sector through the universities, because he thought that too many military things were happening this way. And then they would form the NACA that became NASA, and then became the real honest to God competition. With all of this in mind, the people that were working on rocketry and so on were thinking of space exploration, in general, space exploration. And then as soon as they began to talk about landing on the moon, because this became the objective when Kennedy said it, then they thought about, okay, we're going to the moon, so you really you have to have a science component. Now, the engineers never liked the whole notion, because they would, at the very beginning, before Apollo 11, they would tell us, we would say, and then when they land, they will do this and that, and get rocks of that, or say, hey, listen, guys, no time for this. Our mandate is to send a man to the moon and bring him safely to the Earth. It did not say, and bring back some dirt. So this was some of the engineers that were worrying about the safety of the mission and the achieving that goal had no science, put the science in the back burner. But we were there to push for it, so there was a scientific component from the very outset. Yeah, go ahead.
So kind of playing off of that, I was just curious, you know, the Apollo program is obviously this massive project with lots of people, lots of, like, not just bureaucracy, but sub-bureaucracies and interest groups and everything else. And the science component is only one small part of that.
Yeah.
And obviously, it was mostly engineering, but even the engineering was one small component of this larger structure. So in terms of trying to advocate for science and sort of trying to advance certain objectives within the Apollo program, what kinds of obstacles or constraints did you run into as far as either bureaucratic obstacles or personality conflicts? Sort of the general idea is, like, if you're working in a large organization and trying to advance an agenda, do you have any thoughts about good or bad ways to do that?
Yeah, very good.
The number one reason for the success of sciences in Apollo was the management. The management of NASA at the time was unreal. I've never seen anything like it, and I'm sure I will not. The number one, the very first, the highest management of, who's the first name? Yeah? No, Grover. Yeah. Jim Webb. James Webb was the administrator of NASA, and he is the one that kind of shaped NASA management and the scheme of NASA. Meaning trying to, even though it's a huge thing, he wanted to, he kind of showed that it must be something that each and everyone thinks that it is his. I will never forget that when I became supervisor, they called us up and they said, the administrator is going to meet with all the new supervisors. We're 16 people, supervisors within the NASA headquarters affair. So they got us into a room in NASA, with a government gray room with four chairs, each in rows like that, 4x4. And we're sitting very quietly, nobody even talking to anybody, waiting for the administrator, Jim Webb, the administrator of the whole thing, we're gonna come down here and talk to us or say something to us, and all sitting very quietly. So we entered the room, we thought that he would like this, and he entered the room from the door, and we thought he's gonna come here and say a few words to us. He went in, and then went to the back row, one by one, and he stood to the guy was sitting, and he stood next to him and shook hands with him and said, "My name is Jim Webb," and he waited for him to tell him his name. "Oh, I'm very glad to meet you, Jack. My name is Jim Webb." But one by one, but we know who he is. One by one, just to make you feel that yeah. And then he was stood up there, and then he said, "And I'm here to." Tell you guys that I'm very proud to be working with you. He's working with us. And he kept on to show that it is really the matter in every, in each and every one of us, the whole program depends on what you do personally. And so this is one. This is transferred also on the next row, the next bunch. You are all familiar with Siemens as a program director, but the one that is had more of an impact is the one that followed him right away, which is Rocco Patrone. Rocco was the director of the launch facility at the Cape. There were all kinds of messes with the rocketry, with the every launch that like this, with them like that, and come down like that, or flip like this and blast and so on. And they got this Rocco, who is an engineer like you guys, an engineer from in the army, and he had a PhD in engineering for rocketry, and they assigned him to the Cape. And he told me once when I got to this when the whole business was all messed up, I fired a few people. Got some heads knocked together for a while, and then I said, "There is not going to be a single bad launch or for any reason." I get all my men, and they went with each manager to talk to them. And I thought about what Jim Webb got done to each and every one. And from there on, there were the launches or the test launches were all great, and he became kind of the spokesman for science in general, Rocco Patrone. And there is no question about the fact that it was just the management style of NASA at the time, because of the competition with the Russians, and this was the driver at the very beginning, and whenever you're working on something that you would say to each other, or the engineers would be sitting and telling, listen, guy, you're going to have to do this right, and so on. You're not going to get the Ruskies beat us. You go do the damn thing and come back with it. So meaning this was part of the whole sense at the time. So there was a great deal of managerial input, the best practices of management, of making absolutely certain that each component, each person had a role to play, and this role can be very significant. And that's how it did progress.
Could you say on that topic, could you say a little bit about Bellcom?
Yeah.
And what it was like to work there, and was it an advantage to be part of NASA or disadvantage?
It's a beautiful example because of Jim Webb's think. Jim Webb thought about the fact that one of the most difficult problems for NASA in the future is going to be to communicate. How it is, whether it's a thing that's going to be roaming around the Earth, and how in the hell do we communicate with it? Go wherever you might be, how do you do that? What is this communication? So knowing that he would need help, so he writes a letter to the chairman of AT&T. AT&T at that time was a huge operation that had Bell Labs, and they were the best research operation in the country. The American telephone company had Bell Labs, which was just a fantastic laboratory. It was closed a few years ago, which is very sad. But,
It became loosened.
And so he writes a letter to the chairman of the board of Bell Labs to tell him that we're going to embark on a program to do the such and such of the moon and ta-ta-ta. And one of the most important significant aspects is the communications with the between the Earth and the spacecraft, whatever it may be. And we'd like you to get your best people from in your company to consider this. And we'd come to NASA headquarters, work with us collectively. And because it is such a national objective and an honor to be doing it, we'd like you to make it a company that would work on expenses plus $1 a day. That's it. So expenses plus $1 a day, meaning that you're going to do this because you want to, guys. The chairman brought in the board, and they talked about it, and we're going to do this, and with the moon, and so on, whatever, signed it, and with it. They brought in the best minds from Bell Labs or whatever they may be to NASA headquarters as part of NASA headquarters. The offices were part of NASA headquarters, and it was called Bellcom, Bell Telephone Communications Company, working with NASA at NASA headquarters. So our offices were part of the offices of the Apollo program director. And that worked very nicely because whenever we went anywhere within NASA centers, we had the NASA headquarters badge because we were NASA headquarters people. So but at headquarters, we're Bellcom. Yeah. So it was really worked out very nicely. When I go to Houston or the Cape or wherever, I'm NASA headquarters. So when I say something, it can be listened to. And and when I'm at NASA headquarters, I'm Bellcom. They are paying me to give them the right advice. And none of these people are my bosses. My bosses are actually like Bian Ross, that was at Bell Labs manager. He was the head of Bellcom. So I report to him. I don't report to NASA headquarters. And therefore, when I go to Rocco Patrone, I tell him, what the hell, this is nonsense. We don't do this with ta-ta-ta-ta-ta because he's not my boss. None of his people can tell him that. And they loved it, and they used it. It was a very, very clever move by Jim Webb.
To return to the question of landing sites, if we return to the moon, when we return to the moon, where would you like to land?
Oh, the far side. It's vastly different. Yes,
rather than the South Pole or the Shackleton Crater.
Well, for the water, it's I would think the water mission should be a very high priority. Yeah, but to learn about the moon in general and its composition and the way it formed, we need something on the far side.
Is there any reason to think that the far side, other than the fact that we haven't visualized it except from orbit,
Yeah, compositionally, that all kinds of things that are very,
very different, and we don't know why. And the height of the its own elevation and this. So there are all kinds of basic items and about the far side that are different from the side that we see. In addition to the fact that the center of gravity of the moon is shifted towards the Earth, and so what is the bulk in here like?
Were there any engineering trade-offs performed on the design of the landing module directly because of information that you provided about the moon surface?
I mean, experiments?
As in, like, was there any like particular area on the landing module that was designed solely because of certain information?
In general terms, that's all. That the fact that the leg of the landing, the lander had that little thing because of this, the dust. So it will not be just a stick that will go up in the dust, so that you had a kind of a bowl-shaped lander, so they can stay there rather than, because they were afraid that one of them, if it was landed on one of the four legs in more dusty place, it would tilt. So rather than that, so that you got these things, but nothing else that really worked. Was designed because of the knowledge on the moon, because we had not been to the moon early enough to change the designs, and these surveyor landings were not separated from the design of the LEM by enough years to affect. So most of the LEM design was from the engineering and aviation kind of avionics point of view. In the back.
Can you?
I've read that some authors think that Apollo 16 was the most scientifically important mission, because before that there was this thought that like everything or many things were volcanic, and obviously there were very few volcanics at that site. Did you have that view that Apollo 16 was particularly important in sort of changing the view of our community on the moon?
Yeah, we thought so.
And we were dead wrong. Yeah, Apollo. The Apollo 16 site is perhaps the only site that was selected for the wrong reason, and I was very heavily part of that. There is no question. In general, we knew about the fact that all of the big things around the large basins were formed by the impact, and in the southern part of the highlands right here. They're very far from these features, and we saw this, what we call them, the furrowed highlands. You get the hills like that, but long ridges like this, all of them. And we thought that these long ridges must be volcanic in nature, and they may have been kind of, because we have these kinds of hilly, gentle, rolling hills that are from volcanic seepages. So we thought that this would be, if we go there, we would have something that is completely different from the anorthosites that we see here, or the anorthosites that we picked up here, and the basalts in here. So this would be a third type of rock, a completely different type of rock, because it will have more acidity in it, more like granite of that kind of nature. And we selected Apollo 16 based on that notion. And there were only three people, really, that were pushing it like crazy, including me. It was Dan Wilhelms, Han Mazurski, and myself were pushing this whole notion that's a completely different type of rock. That would be the most important site on the moon, because it will have give you a different kind of rock, ta-ta-ta-ta. And during the mission, as soon as we heard them talk about it, we knew that we all messed up, or even with an F. so we realized that what they landed in here was just an accumulation of ejecta in that kind of shape. So it was an ejecta blanket from big, large basins. Just a different shape of depositional material from a large impact site. So it's the same material as we picked up from everywhere else, but in a different placement, in a different shape of the placement. So it was the one side that was wrongly selected. Yes?
You hear a lot about the exploits of the actual astronauts who landed on the moon and some of the activities they partook in, but can you talk about some of the contributions that the command module pilots made as they orbited the moon in terms of gathering scientific data?
Yeah, and this is maybe the way I am related to the Apollo program most, in the training of the command module pilots on what to photograph, how to see it, how to take a stereo pair camera, because we didn't have stereo at the very beginning, and until we had a camera that, if you can also date it obliquely to take a picture, and we taught them how to take a picture, and then say one potato, two potato, three potato, click, one potato, so they can have the time between the two, looking at the same site, and get a perfect stereo pair. And so they didn't know how to push for it. Rather than look for the seconds, you just say one petite. that came from NASA engineers. They loved it, and we applied it, and it worked. But the observations of what is important and what is significant was critical. I'll give you two examples. Al Warden on Apollo 15. At the very corner of one of these basins right here, saw something what he described to us as cinder cones. Cinder cones, we know geologically that they have seen the cinder cones in Flagstaff, Arizona, which is a little a perfectly shaped volcanic cone like that, volcanic cone. And this is cinder, which is the last gasp of volcanism in general, would be this kind of thing where it comes out, poof, and it deposits all the dust around it on the side like that. So called it cinder, because it's fine grain, and the cone, it's a cone shape. And he saw this, and he said the dark halos, and this because the dark halo meant a lot to us. And that's, we selected the site of the Apollo 15 mission based on this observation. And on the Apollo 17 mission, Jack Schmidt saw something that he called orange soil, and we said, what the hell is that might be? And he said something about fumarolic activity. This is when you have something from the interior of the moon, when it comes out, heated material with fluids and gases, or both of them, or one of them, and would come to a place like this, and it will actually tint that color differently. So we thought this would be the very last of the last gasp of volcanism, because he mentioned this fumarolic activity, something coming around from the lunar interior. And we thought that this would be something that is very young and very different from the kinds of things that we had. And we started even talking to the press at the time that this means the moon is younger than we thought. And it turned out. But I called Ron Evans, who was in lunar orbit. I told them, where is that location exactly? I said, look at it and see exactly, can you recognize that that orange soil? And he did. So I said, great, because it's a huge distance, and this was a small place. And I said, now look at around the whole revolution, see whether you can see anything like this at all. Meaning, is this a unique location, or is this something that we can see anywhere else on the moon? And he started looking, and on the other side of the same basin right here, he saw a lot of these. So we knew that this is not a unique case like that, and it is something. And after they brought back the rocks and we looked at them, indeed it's part of the old material and it's nothing unique. So it was very carefully, we go back to the interpretation of what you're looking at, and that the contribution of man in doing. Yes, you.
So I wondered if you could talk a little bit about the advancement of the instrumentation that you use to get these measurements. I think you talked that you were involved with the photography at the beginning. And then as you advance the photographic techniques, I understand your star field registration got a lot better, your robustness of the photography with different lighting conditions got better. Mm-hmm. And then through to the flight, the design of flight of the SIM. With laser melting, those sorts of more advanced instruments. How did that come about? How did you make that shift more towards the science from just maybe engineering? Mm-hmm. Yeah,
that's also an excellent question, because we knew that after the Apollo program ended, we will not have except the data that we collect there. And so we had to collect then, became an important thing. So we would say, for instance, we need a metric camera to take real, honest-to-God topographic maps of the moon for future missions, whatever they may be, because here we didn't have topography. So because of the N numbers, it was just a nonsensical kind of thing that we put. We didn't have real, honest-to-God topographic maps. So we wanted to have preparing for future missions to the moon, because we knew that the lunar surface, the dark areas on the moon, the dark places, what you see in the man on the moon, they, all of them have a high percentage of titanium, and titanium is a fantastic element. I mean, so we use titanium all kinds of things. And when we find a basalt rock that has 40% titanium, this is an ore good enough to mine. On the moon, all of the surface, all of the basalts on the moon have from 4 to 11% titanium. So we knew that there is something that might be mined later on the moon, and so we're going to use it. And so we would need maps, and we need topographic maps of that good enough, and to do it like that, and so on. And so we think about that, and therefore, what is that system would look like? Well, you would have, if you are in lunar orbit and you want to take photography so that you can make maps of it, you have a camera that would look and photograph a piece of it right here, and then another piece, and another piece with 60% overlap so that you can get stereo. But while you are in the spacecraft like that, we cannot depend on the spacecraft positioning that so we know where that picture was taken exactly. So we had to have a camera to take a star field at the same instant when it clicks. This one also clicks to get a picture of a star field so we know exactly where you are. Because if the spacecraft was moving like this, you would be taking that star field. If it's like this, you're taking that star field. So you get the orientation of the spacecraft to the nth degree. And so this will give you the possibility of looking at this here with a camera for map making. But with this camera for map making, we cannot see the detail. So we need a camera to photograph in the same strip in great detail. So we put in the spacecraft, also wanted to put a spacecraft, a camera that would sit here and would take a panoramic view, as this one is taking that, would take a panoramic view of a whole thing with resolution in here, say 1 meter. 1 meter resolution, so they can see any block that's 1 meter in size, because we thought also in the future missions we need to know that for any future missions. So with these things are huge, that panoramic camera is 7 feet long. Yes. So we had to take a piece of the side of the CSM out to put that in, yeah. And the film magazine is very heavy and cumbersome, so because the astronaut has to go out and take it out and put it back into this spacecraft. So these are huge requirements for you really had to fight like crazy. In addition to all of that, you also wanted to know what the elevation of these things that you had. So you had a laser altimeter. As the spacecraft moves, it keeps then clicking, and so that you get the exact height between the spacecraft and the for the photography to fix it, and also for knowledge of the lunar shape. Yeah. So there were all kinds of things that had to be justified, and without this Rocco Patrone as the Apollo program director, I don't think that we really would have been able to get all of that we got in there, because he became enthralled with he has a PhD himself, but he got enthralled with the whole notion of the scientific mission, the scientific value of the program, and what is it that we can get from all of these missions one by one, and he just backed up all of these things consistently, and he's the one that fought for them in Congress, because we in each one of these added a chunk of cash, yeah.
Sure. Yeah. And then as a corollary to that, you know, I'm sure there were limitations on what you couldn't fly. So I guess if the sky were the limit, what instruments would you have liked to fly, but you couldn't?
They were very much like the communication satellites. Okay. Yeah, number one for better communications, mm-hmm. with them all the time, particularly when on the far side of the moon. When on the far side, we don't hear, we don't see, we don't hear. So what the hell is that? They're going where they're like here, and we can look at them and hear them only when they're here. But when they are here in the back of the backside, we don't. So why not? And we tried with Ken Mattingly, I think, for Apollo 16 to provide something for Apollo 20 for a communications. And that would have been, by the way, easy enough to do the Tsiolkovsky and the Farside. We thought of a mission on the Farside with these communications satellites, because you only need two to get two communications satellites moving around while the spacecraft is there, and then you'll be able to land on the Farside and communicate constantly from the Farside and so on. That's the one thing that was, they said no. Yes?
How much of a game change for the science program was having the Lunar Rover and the Lunar missions?
Huge game change. It's the ability to be able to move away from the landing point to 7 kilometers made a huge change. Because if you select a place that is flat and so on for the lander to be in here, then there is no way for you to walk that distance to get a sample from this location. But the rover allowed it. So it was a huge change to allow you to maneuver within the site and go to different places very swiftly within the capacity for oxygen. We could not do it longer than 7 kilometers, because that is the maximum for the oxygen if they walk back. If the computer or the rover died, then they have to walk back. So, and to walk back with whatever oxygen they had. And so this was the limitation. But the rover could go farther. And we thought that on Apollo 15, the rover would go into a rill. We had a structure like that, and we thought that we would be able to do that. But when they get to it, and there was, the engineers didn't really like it, but the astronauts were trying to assure them that they will not do it unless they know, because we wanted to have a sample from some of the layers in here underneath the surface. But the tilt was too dangerous. And the rover allowed them to go to the edge, see it, photograph it.
On the tilt, the perceived tilt was very different than the actual tilt, mm-hmm. right? And the astronauts frequently were mistaken, mm-hmm. thinking that they would fall into the crater. Mm-hmm. Later, I think it was related to some of the optical characteristics.
It's optical characteristics, yes. Yeah.
You feel that's now well understood?
I think so, yeah. In the future, I don't know, because the all of the equipment is improving now. There is also a kind of
enormous change that you guys are making in the engineering field. That you could, all kinds of things that we will be able to communicate constantly with the robot and change its shape and change its maneuvering and so on. So I think with today's breakthroughs in robotics, maybe we would not need that. And the only reason for saying that it was so significant was also the competition with the Russians, because this is a huge thing, the fact. Because we had all kinds of missions before Apollo that nobody gave a damn, and landings and pictures and taking and you name it. They went to them, they sent something, they wanted to take a picture. Yeah. Good luck. And that was it. But when there was a fear that the Soviets are going to go to the moon first, that shook up American minds. And it satisfied the American psyche after the Apollo 11 mission. And that is not really the end of it. But as far as I'm concerned, it is the reason for the position of America to this day, the position of America in the world. The fact that the U.S. government can say, no, we're not going to do that in Syria, and we'll tell Iran to stop all of this hullabaloo that we're doing is based only because Armstrong landed on the moon first. All of this big scheme, and we have such and such, and we do this and that. Yeah, because in general, after the Apollo mission, they landed a man on the moon, and they can do such and such. So they could do anything, meaning that we, Americans, can do anything. And indeed, it's because of this event, the whole world began to look east, to look west, meaning towards America. From anywhere in the world, you looked, boom. Everybody looked west towards America. What happened in the 60s? American cars, American television, American the refrigerators, American television. Anywhere you go in the world, it's American products because it's the best. Because it's it. Why? Because they went to the moon. That's all. I was once in a country called Oman. Anybody know where Oman is? Okay, 2 people out of 20. Oman is at the southern tip of Arabia. And there is a section of Oman that is very hilly, up on top of the plateau, that the people there don't even speak Arabic. They could speak a language called Jibali, meaning mountain groans, just not real language. And I was there doing some geological work, and here is one local man came from nowhere, and to look at us, we're looking, we're dressed here differently from what he sees here. And he says, "Where are you people? Where are you from?" And one man from my group spoke Jibali. And we started talking and so on, and they asked him whether he knew about, I was born in Egypt. Do you know where Egypt is? He said, this way here. Do you know where America is? He says, no. Have you heard of Clinton? Bill Clinton was the president then. Have you ever heard of Clinton? He said, no. You don't know where America is? He said, no. And then he said, ah. But Americans landed on the moon. So that's what I mean by the whole goddamn world began to look towards that American. Now, mark my words, you're young enough to see it. I believe that the next mission to the moon will be Chinese. And I also believe that the first person to land on the moon will be a Chinese woman, because they have already taken a whole bunch of women in their space program. And I'm saying, and I wrote that in an editorial in one of these space magazines, the title was Before the World Looks East, because I would say that when this happens, there's a whole generation that doesn't even know what Apollo is, this or this and that. And if Russian or if Chinese people, including women, landed on the moon, the whole world will look at it. And the refrigerators, the cars, will be bought from China. Next.
So sort of on that topic, earlier you talked about how the management style of NASA enabled such great science and sort of engineering achievement, along with the competition from the Soviet Union. I haven't heard NASA praised as much for management style in recent years. and so my question is, how do you think, with the lack currently of the same sort of competition that appeared in the Cold War, how do you think that NASA could recapture that fire and sort of light up the system again?
There would have to be a whole new program. I think the space shuttle killed NASA. The space shuttle was a disaster from day one for several reasons. Number one, it would have been something that you build in 1970s, all of them. You build aircraft, kind of, in 1970s. So you're going to use the technology of the 70s. And you're going to have them forever. So you'll be working in the 90s and 2000 with 1970 technology. Rocco Patron, the guy that I'm praising a lot, resigned from NASA because of this, because of this shuttle. The space shuttle is the as you all know it, and I'm sure you have astronauts here talk about it and all that, you have the main thing, and you have the two thrusters on either side that initiate the burn, the liftoff. The two that use liquid fuel. Okay, liquid fuel has never been used on things from space before. Solid fuel, the boosters. Our liquid fuel has always been used on missions to space, because liquid fuel you can turn off. It's a nozzle. You just turn it off. But with solid fuel, you can't. If something goes wrong, you can't lift. And in the meeting with NASA at NASA headquarters when this was being talked about in 1971, and then they were talking about it, and Houston came with the whole notion of the space shuttle. And the notion then was, it is going to be so easy to go in. There will be one mission a week, and there will be everything on the space shuttle is reusable, and with solid fuel boosters. And rocket patrol says, we never used solid fuel boosters for manned missions for good reason. Because with liquid fuel, you turn the nozzle on. It's a movement. You turn it on or off. In solid fuel, you start it, you got it. You have it. It's going to burn until it ends. He said, now, what if one of these stopped working and this one works? Then this one, the spacecraft is going to go up like that and land here or over Miami or Orlando. That we're going to use solid fuel boosters over my dead body. And his boss, George Lowe, who was the administrator of NASA, then say, Rocco, so be it, because they had decided already. And Rocco resigned the following day from NASA headquarters because of that. And then the fact that you have this whole system done in 1970s, and then you're still going to be used it for 20 years, that killed NASA. That killed innovation. That killed the whole notion of you do something and you do it for now, and then you modify it, the engineering changes, the mics changed. The mics that were used in the shuttle were like remember the big mics that were used like this, and this was in the wall of the space shuttle for our longest time. This was in the old early missions. All the talk of the astronauts, you hear it, you can't hear it because the big microphones were in back of the thing. Nobody had designed these kinds of things. Yeah, it was the old one. So, and everything else is like that. So there was no way of doing it unless you take the whole wall of the shuttle, which they did many times, and to change the computer, because the computer is based on 1970 technology. You have to, every few years, you had to change them. So you change the computers and change this, and the cost, and the tiles that didn't work right, and so it was, there is no question about the fact that this notion of reusable shuttle and buying all five so that you can work with them for 20 years was just a bad choice.
Talk a little more about on the J missions, the relative value of adding the Simbay instruments to more training for the command module pilots. I don't often read a lot about results from instruments in the Simbay, but you do sometimes see a lot more about better observations that the CMPs made on the later missions.
With the Simbay, you had number one, all of these imaging systems, the cameras. Without them, we would not have the maps of the moon that we have today. We have lots of maps, both large scale and small scale maps that are perfectly correct, and actually in many ways, and that is why we started mapping systems or imaging systems around the Earth, because near the end of Apollo 1970, in the middle of the Apollo program in 1970, we had a meeting in the U.S. government. I was working with the Smithsonian Institution then, planned to make imaging system of the Earth so that we can have maps of the Earth the way we had maps on the moon, because the maps of the moon were better than any of the maps of the United States of America because of these systems. Yeah, the maps that we could make of the moon at that time were better than any of the maps of any place in the U.S. because of the imaging systems that we applied. In addition to that, we had the instruments that measured the chemical changes, the variations in the chemistry, so that we now know that all of the whitish material and this is composed of what, and the dark material in here is made of what, and this is the basis of the fact that we know that all of it is basalt and all came from volcanic eruptions after these holes were made and so on. So both the chemical and the imaging systems were so significant, and the laser, so significant information about the whole moon that added a lot more than what the astronauts could do in individual spots.
Could you talk about, there were two types of astronauts at the end of the day, engineering trained test pilots, and then one PhD geologist.
Yeah.
As a scientist on the ground, and there was, as you know, a lot of controversy and conversation about which, As a scientist on the ground, which did you prefer, or how did they compare as far as the scientific work that, that you were working on?
Jack Smith didn't add much to the scientific deliberation. He also kind of put us astray with that comment about the fumaroles and the orange soil. And that was a bullshit statement at the time, but it just put us on a different level that was totally wrong. And many of us had to retract our statements, and it just wasn't right enough. In the meantime, I would actually say that the engineers that became interested in the scientific aspects of their specific mission, rather than the science of geology as a whole, became so well focused because of their engineering minds, because they're so well focused that they provided good information, and it could have been better than the interpreting minds of the sciences in general. So I really think that if you compare the performance of Jack Schmidt to Dave Scott or Gene Cernan on the ground, they did a little better because they were focused solely on the kinds of things that they learned about this damn thing, and he has this general notion of the whole Earth and the whole Moon and Mars and Jupiter and whatever. Yeah. They were more focused on their specific objective, and they knew how to do it because they're engineers. I hope you all guys know that.
I'm probably happy to hear that.
I think, I hope you, all of you, like that.
Could you tell the story of your contribution to the Apollo 13 crisis?
Apollo 13? Just in the pictures.
Sorry?
In the pictures?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. You all know what happened with Apollo 13, and there was an explosion, and something happened, and we had no idea what did happen there, and we're all talking about it and mulling around, and Rocco Patron was up in the control center, and he came straight down to me. Said, Farouk, you train the guys. We will need pictures of what happened to the spacecraft. You know how to tell them? You work on getting us pictures of this crap, because there will be all kinds of talk. Without a picture, we will never know what exactly happened, which is a very good thing. I mean, you heard something, but we don't know what it is. Because at the time, we just heard everybody in the spacecraft heard a boom, an explosion. And everybody knew that they lost the power, and so they had no idea exactly what. So, and he said, we need pictures. And that was just an incredible call, because it is to work on a picture like this in a setting like that. We never really photographed the spacecraft, right? What am I going to take a picture of a spacecraft, and how am I going to take a picture? But because you're inside the spacecraft. But as you know, the spacecraft, the CSM, is made of these two components. It is where the astronauts live. This is where we have the instrumentation and the fuel tanks and so on, and that's the engine. So here you're going to be here. And they are going to go all around the moon and come back in the same setting, connected to the LEM in here. But they're going to dump that before they leave to the moon. They leave the moon because it's no longer useful. And they're going to use this engine to get them back towards the Earth. And before they land on the Earth, they separate this from that, because that's the only piece that will land with the parachute. So when they separate is the only time that you have to look from a window in here, somewhere, and some window, they have five windows, to look in some direction, because you don't know what the separation is going to happen, and take a picture of this, hoping that the sun will be shining, hoping that you'll get to the right place, hoping that the orientation is such and such, hoping that the rotation of the spacecraft is not too far, too fast, and hoping that they're hoping that this is a, and therefore, you get down to instead of hoping, you get down to say exactly what is it, and then convey this to a totally untrained astronaut, because Jack Swigert had replaced Kim Mattingly. Kim Mattingly would have done it very easily. But Kim Mattingly was exposed to measles and so on, and the backup guy went up. And this is the only backup in the whole program that didn't really give a damn. He was a great pilot, a seat of a pan pilot. He didn't really like simulations, and he didn't like training sessions at all. He would sit down in a training session. We would go in the Cape, and we have dinner and so on. And by 8:30, he said, Farouk, let's get down. Enough is enough. Man, let's go get a beer. And that's when. So he was the only one that didn't really want to hear a thing about. So I knew that he would need very simple, very specific instructions to get that picture from a window in the spacecraft. So it took me 30 hours of work full time, non-stop, not even 1 second, of 30 hours between the flight planners, between the guys that would work on the separation speed, on the rotation, on the guys that would see where the sun is, on to all the little pieces of that, to make a list, a very simple list, because he is not with it. A little list for Jack Swigert to tell him what to do exactly, what magazine to put where, and how to put it, and how to search and search, and go to which window, and look from what side, ta-ta-ta, and click. And my God, we got it.
If there were more manned missions to the moon in the future, what kind of scientific experiments would you like to see being conducted?
More the things that look into the interior, or figure out them more about the structure of the interior. Because the lunar interior is still enigmatic to us. We have some ideas, but it's very much like geological ideas. Well, huh? There's a crust of this thickness and that one, but we don't really know exactly what it is and how far and what kind of condition it is. And there are instrumentations with the measuring seismic waves and even the shape of the moon and this and that would give us a little more information on the lunar interior. Because that, if you have a better view of the lunar interior, you have a better view of the way it formed and how it is shaped. Especially in the early history. Ah, sorry.
What were your thoughts or feelings when you were first approached for the Apollo program?
I was thrilled. I had come to this country with no job. I had returned because after the PhD in lead and zinc, I actually spent a couple of years in Heidelberg teaching lead and zinc minerals. And then I went to Egypt and tried to get a job in geology. I could not find anything. They wanted me to teach chemistry. Since I wasn't able really to do it, I refused. But I stayed there for a whole year with absolutely no job at all. I had married an American girl from Boston and had a baby, and the second baby was on the way. So I had to find something. So we got the hell out of there and came back here and started looking for jobs until I found that one. And I applied just out of no reason whatsoever. And I went down to interview. And the guy that first interviewed me was Ed Nixon, who is the brother of Richard Nixon, who had a master's degree in geology from the University of Alaska. So we had a nice talk. And then he introduced me to the big bosses of Belcom, and we had a discussion, and they hired me. With the big boss at Belcom, at least my boss at Belcom, said to the geologist when the geological survey that we hired an Egyptian to work on with us for geology, but I don't think he'll work out. So this was the revision. Yeah, he's an Egyptian. What could he do? So and I went there and did well. Yes.
So I watch
a recent interview you had with Riz Khan, and you discussed how going to Mars, for example, would be very inspirational for the public and also a very good science mission. Mm-hmm. As one of the foremost experts on deserts, and you said that Mars is very similar to deserts on Earth. What can we learn from going to Mars?
Very much about what formed the desert features, because the desert features on Earth were, in all cases, have hints to a geologist like me that they were formed by water, because you see these channels, or the meandering channels. And there is no geological reason for making meandering channels except water, surface water running, but make a wadi, a valley. And so if you see that on Mars, we know these are the kinds of things that are really actually very active on the Earth. But if you see them on Mars, you know that there must have been quite a bit of surface water and moving on the surface of the planet at some time in the past. So the relationship can be very, very similar. Some of the features that we see on Mars with the plateaus and in the channel lands and in the deposits, the layer deposits and so on, which are also in the desert, resulting from the deposition by water. And then the dunes, beautiful dunes on Mars. The largest field of sand dunes that we know of is around the North Polar region of Mars. So sand dunes form just like the sand dunes in the desert, that guys take the jeeps and go up and down. There is that much, many more on Mars like that. So there's quite a bit of relationship between the dry lands of the Earth and the whole surface of Mars. So working with them together would certainly, or learning more about Mars, can certainly give us some hints of what the desert might be like. And figuring out all of the features on Mars would help in our interpretation of where water might have been, and therefore where ice might have been, and so on. And some of these features are stunningly identical. At one time, I took one picture from something called Landsat, from pictures of space of southwest Egypt, of a plateau called Gilf Kebir. And I cut out the border of it. And I took it to a meeting that we were going to look at some of the very early pictures of Mars with Hal Mazursky, Carl Sagan, and we sat down, eight guys on the table. And I took a picture, and then Hal Mazursky was right next to me, and I said, Hal, where is this from? And had looked at it, I think, that might, because of this thing in right here, it might be in the Planitia. And Carl Sagan said, let me see that. I see, could be very well measured. And it moved all the way there to the random. I took up but the picture that I cut out, I said, this is Southwest Egypt. What? It was absolutely stunning to them that these kinds of features would be so identical to each other. So if you have that kind of relationship, then there is no question about the fact. The more that you learn about the deserts, the more you'll be able to better interpret the surface of Mars. The more you learn about Mars features, the better you understand what the desert would look like if that is the nature from the present condition, the environmental conditions of Mars.
Yes.
Going back to the original preparation for the original landings, you mentioned you used photometry to try to assess the slopes and gradients potential landing areas. What did you have in terms of an ability to get ground truth or compare that against other instrumentation? Because obviously the rocks are different colors, mm-hmm. and so, you know, is it darker because the slope is different, or is it darker because the rock is darker?
No, the areas that we were working on were all dark rock in the flat regions. Yeah, we were limiting ourselves. Like if there was a ridge in here, we excluded it. That is of whiter material. So all of the areas that we picked, the squares that we picked for the N number, were all identical in shape to us, the general shape, and in darkness, meaning it's the same kind of rock. Otherwise, it would have been very difficult. Yes. Yeah.
Is
Despite the fact that the LEM didn't actually sink into like a bottomless pit of dust, there must have been some concerns regarding dust in terms of like debris blowback or like, you know, dust out conditions. How did you go out, how did you go about predicting the depth of the dust layer you find at the landing sites?
We really couldn't. There was no, we knew that there will be some, but we knew it is not atomic gold. So it is that we knew that there will be some, but that some is, and it actually differed from mission to mission. How much of that, and we see that now with the pictures of all of these sites with the new instruments. We've just, I just looked at this actually today. There is a another instrument that is photographing the moon at very high resolution. And it took quite good pictures of the landing sites of Surveyor and Luna and Luna Hood and Apollo, all of them, all of the things, Soviet and otherwise. Of the moon's surface, and each one has a very different imprint on the surface. So there, each and every one depending on the thickness of that very fine dust in that place, and it differed actually from the Surveyor site, from the Apollo 11 site, because the Surveyor site, we know it is not the volcanic basalt, the dark one, is not very thick in there, so the rock surface is different a little bit from that one. So, and you could see that from the amount of dust that the spacecraft has spread around and at the point of impact. Good question. And it varies from place to place, but small variations.
Just one little personal question. I have to ask, how did you earn the nickname the King during the Apollo program?
Yeah. I think this was the Apollo 14 or 13, yeah. Either 13 or 14. They were talking to each other, and then somebody said, "What the hell do we call this geologist from Egypt?" And somebody else, "Well, Egypt has King Farouk. He's the king." and then it became official when Apollo 15. When Al Warden would not even call my name, he just called the king. Tell the king such such such. And then and if the Capcom would say, the king says such 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 such. Because they are enough, they are older enough generation, not like you guys. They're old enough generation when they said, when they hear Egypt, they think of the king of Egypt. Not to you guys, you don't know that. You don't even know where Egypt is. So, but at that time, the king of Egypt was a very famous personality. Everybody said they knew about him. He's supposed to have been a playboy galore and da da da. Everybody in the world knew about King Farouk in Egypt. But and that's why when you think about Egypt, you think of the king.
Okay, one last question.
So it was by default. Yes.
Were you able to take kind of the problem solving of having to figure out the geology of the moon and apply it to some of the research that's done on deserts here? Because it seems like, you know, it's a very abstract problem because you can't touch it, you can't go check it out, and you have to figure it all out from pictures ahead of time. And then did that help a lot in a lot of the research that you've done since then?
Very much so. And we would take the things about when we actually went several times to the southwestern desert in Egypt, specifically to look at the details of some of the features there so that we can expect what kind of detail is going to be like that on Mars. Yeah, so we could perceive, knowing about the lunar, the Martian landforms and the way they interact with each other, by experimentation in deserts in Egypt. And we began that. And I bet this will continue for a long time. If the Martian missions continue, there will be more correlations between these two. Good question, too.
Okay.
Thank you.
Interesting discussion. Thank you
very much.